Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. This is the second video implementing the rotate left absolute addressing opcode. In the previous video, we did all of the preliminary work, figured out how many cycles the command needs to run, what it needs to do on each cycle, and we also wrote the test bench, the test plan that automatically verifies that the command does what it's supposed to do. So with all of the preliminary work out of the way, let's delve right into where we left off the previous time. So that's our test plan. That's what we expect the program to do. Unsurprisingly, that's not what it will do, simply because we haven't implemented the opcode yet. Now we can run the simulation and we get an assert failure. It says opcode shorter than expected. And we said that it needs to take 6 cycles. However, if we look at the simulation, we see that it only took 2 cycles until the sync went high again, which makes sense because our CPU thinks that's an operation. As we continue to implement opcodes in the CPU, all we have to do in order to make sure we haven't broke the rotate left opcode is run the simulation. It will automatically make sure everything's in order. With that out of the way, we can finally start implementing the actual opcode. The first place we need to look is at the decoder. If you'll recall, the decoder is the largest portion of the CPU, and it hinges around this case. If we go to 2E, here we go, that's our rotate left. So, uncomment this part. We need to set the active operation to rotate left, and we're telling it that the address mode is absolute addressing. This makes sure that the first 3 cycles of the instruction handling will read the opcode, obviously, and then the two parts of the address, the least significant and most significant parts of the address. They also make sure to put the correct address in the data latch. Our CPU uses a 16-bit data latch. And whenever we need to handle 16-bit values, such as absolute addressing addresses, we construct it byte by byte in the data latch. So right now we don't really care how. All we do care about is that when we finally get to the opcode implementation, the data latch is going to have the address where our operand is in memory. So all we have to do now is go to the opcode processing, which is in this file. And the actual processing is done in this switch case. So we're looking, and I'm keeping this alphabetized so I know where things are. We're looking for rotate left and we do opcode ROL. Simple as that. Of course, we need to actually implement it. This is this task. Do opcode ROL, begin and end task. Here we go. The first time this function will be called is during the last cycle of the address processing. During that cycle, we can set the control lines that will take effect during the first actual cycle of opcode. So the first cycle of actually executing the rotate left opcode will get the control lines that are set during the cycle before that. Since we don't know what cycle number it is in the instruction, just think about it. The absolute addressing mode takes 4 cycles. The absolute indirect take 5 or 6 cycles. Zero page takes 3 cycles. Zero page index takes 6 cycles. So each addressing mode may take a different number of cycles, so we don't know what cycle number we're in. To compensate for that, our timing counter does not simply process linearly. During the address resolution stage, it just increments from 0, and when it switches to the opcode execution, it starts at opcounter start. So if we copy this if into our code, this cycle inside this if is the cycle that takes place before the opcode processing begins. The first thing we want to do is make sure everything's fine. So let's set the address bus ADDR bus source data latch. Let's tell it to read from the data latch. So the data latch will contain the address from which we get the address bus in the next instruction. At which point we can already put the skeleton for all the cycles. So else if timing counter equals op counter start. Plus one, plus two. Now we know that this is the last cycle of the instruction, so we already know we can call next instruction here. So that gives us a sort of skeleton of the opcode rewriting. To see how that works, we can obviously simulate it. So let's go back to the simulation. And run. Now we're still terminating with an assert, but it's a different assert. It actually acknowledges that the command took as many cycles as it should have, but it complained that on the last cycle it expected it to access a different address. We'll get to that. Let's look at the data lines. So the instruction starts here. That is the first cycle of the instruction, and at the end of which we fetch the opcode, which is 2E. We advance the PC to 83B, and on the next instruction, we fetch the least significant byte, which is good, and then 83C, and we fetch the most significant byte. This is the first cycle of the actual opcode execution, and we see that it reads from C7F4. Which is precisely what we want it to do, and it reads the value 9.4, which is what we expected it to do. So far, so good. So what we want to do during this cycle is use the ALU in order to shift everything to the left. This has to happen during this cycle, because that's the first time we actually have the value to read from. Now, as you'll notice, the simulation simulates the timing diagram, which states that the value is only available a little before to a little after the falling edge of the clock. So if we want the shifted value to be valid throughout the cycle, we need to latch it. Thankfully, we do have such a latch. You can see that the data in comes here and goes into data in latched. That's a register that unconditionally latches whatever comes in on the data in. If we go back to the simulation, we actually have data in latched, and we can see that indeed at this point, it copies the 9.4 from the data in and allows us to access it during the entire cycle. So going back to our code, we want the data bus source. If we go to the CPU implementation, and we look at the data bus inputs, we see that setting data bus source mem means reading from data in latched. So that's what we want to do here. Data bus source mem. Next, we want to set the ALU to perform our rotate. The ALU has these commands. We want the shift left command. Looking at the schematics, that the control line goes from ALU op. So we're going to set ALU op to shift left. Of course, we don't want a shift, we want a rotate. In Verilog, the curly braces do bit concatenation. So what this says here is that we're taking our B input, which is an 8-bit input, and concatenating it with the carry in. So that's a 9-bit value. And we're assigning that to the status out carry, which is a 1-bit value, and result, which is an 8-bit value. So the difference, if we want to do an LU op shift left that does a shift, what we need to do is make sure that the carry in is zero. And if we say carry in is the actual carry, this will be a rotate. So the same control line can be either a shift or a rotate, depending on where we set the carry from. Looking at the ALU code in the main CPU, we see that carry in is taken from a line called ALU carry inputs. And it can be either 0, 1. We need to also allow the actual carry. So we'll add a new option now. ALU carry in carry. We'll give it the number 2. We'll set the num options to 3. Of course, we also need to add it to the multiplexer, so we do it here. Assign ALU carry inputs, ALU carry in carry equals, now we need the actual value, and we have it here. Here's the carry definition. Let's see if this compiles so far. If we look at the ALU carry in, we now see that it has 3 options. One is tied to 0, one is tied to 1, and one is taken from the status register. So that's essentially the change we just did. Going back to the routine rewriting, what we need to do is say ALU, all the lines going out are defined in the instruction decode file as the inputs and outputs of the module. And we're looking for ALU carry source. And it needs to get ALU carry. At this point, we also need to set the other flags for the ALU. And all the flags are here. So we want ALU B source. Remember, the ALU performs the shift operation only with the B source, not with the A source. So we don't need to do anything about the A source. The ALU B source needs to be the data bus. Remember, we latched the data in on the data bus, so that's fine to use that as the data source. We don't need to do anything about ALU A source. We've already set the ALU op. The address bus source. We want the address bus to still point on into memory at our operand. So we just copy this line from here. It doesn't actually do anything, but it's compatible and it doesn't really cost us anything to do that. There's one more thing we need to do. When the ALU is done, we want the result to be latched so we can save it into memory. For that, we need the ALU latch. Now you'll notice the ALU latch is unconditional. We do not need to tell it to latch. It automatically does so, and it does so on the rising edge of the clock. So we have that, that's fine. So let's execute this command as it is and see what happens. Go back to the simulation, reload so that our code changes take effect, and execute. As before, we're asserting because not everything is implemented, but that's fine. What we're interesting is to see what happens. So we read from 83A to E, 83B F4, 83C C7, and then we read for two cycles from C7 F4, which is exactly what we want. Next, we want to see what the ALU is doing. ALU B is 9.4, and the ALU result is 2.8, which is exactly what it needs to be. During the second cycle of the instruction, ALU result gets the right value. All we have to do now is write that value to memory. Let's see how we do that. First, the data bus source. Needs to come from the ALU. So we're loading the ALU result on the data bus. The address bus is still the data latch. And we want to set the external read-write line to 0, which means perform a write operation. And theoretically, we're done, or almost done. Let's see if that works. We see that we've actually progressed to the next instruction. So we're pretty good. This is the first cycle, second cycle, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth cycle. And at the end of the cycle, we write, you see the read-write line goes low, and data out contains 2.8, which is exactly what it should contain. And indeed, the verification for this instruction succeeds. The entire simulation finishes successfully. But we're not done. The reason we're not done is because the status value is incorrect. So there you have it. The main operation is implemented. All that's left for us is to implement the updating of the flags, as well as making sure that some of the external pins the CPU has that tells external devices about something about the internal state are updated. Should be easy, right? Anyway, until next time, thank you for watching.